Hello friends, welcome to this presentation. And many of you who have been corresponding with me personally, and we have been sharing some ideas back and forth. And one of the questions that I typically get from some of very serious kind of users is about that, what are the abilities or the capabilities a person should have to have a good handle on the predictive side of the astrology, and they have thought what my personal views are. So I'm going to share my personal views about the ability of an astrologer to make good predictions. And the very first thing that comes to my mind and that I appreciate the most, and I personally follow it also, is about having a critical and analytical approach in astrology. And when somebody has a critical and analytical approach, then I have personally, my own experience is, and I personally believe, then a person can have a good handle on the predictive aspect of the astrology. Now, to drive this point home and to emphasize this point, I have taken one of the theory that was propounded by K. N. Rao long back on the timing of marriage, just to assert that what I mean by having a critical and analytical approach. Now, long back in, I guess, in 1990 or maybe before that, I really don't recall, K. N. Rao and his team produced a series of articles in the astrological magazine where they propounded a theory of how to find the year of marriage using the transit of Jupiter and Saturn. I met K. N. Rao long back, and he's a very nice and humble person. And here in this presentation, when I'm trying to refute this particular theory, I don't mean any disrespect for him. But recently, I was watching one of the videos by a so-called Nadi astrologer, and when he was asked about what kind of procedure he uses for the timing of the marriage, then he mentioned about this particular theory. So I was a little surprised, and in this presentation you will learn that why, you know, I was a little surprised. Let's this particular theory which K. N. Rao propounded in 1990, it was hailed as a major breakthrough in the Indian astrology, and he produced a lot of horoscope. He and his team produced a lot of horoscope, maybe 100 or more than 100, where it was statistically it was shown that in all those horoscopes, this particular theory of double transit of Jupiter and Saturn is all applicable, and this is a foolproof theory, and this is a silver bullet. And at that time, it created a lot of excitement in the astrology world. I remember that when we went through this theory, we were also very overjoyed, and we thought that now we have a silver bullet. Let's quickly, you know, look at what this theory says. Now, this is an example chart of a female, and she got married in January 84. Now, what this theory says is that Saturn and Jupiter must aspect the Lagna or the Lagna Lord, the seventh house or the seventh lord. That is the, I guess, the main, you know, central engine of this particular theory. Now, in the light of this particular theory, let's see what happened in the year 1984. What happened to the transit of Saturn and Jupiter, and how they were fulfilling these two conditions. Now, Jupiter in 84 was in Sagittarius. So Jupiter was here. So from here, it was aspecting the Lagna Lord. So theory says the Lagna and the Lagna Lord. So Lagna condition is fulfilled. And Saturn was in Libra. So Saturn was already, you know, in the seventh house. So this theory seems to fulfill these conditions 100%. Similarly, a lot of horoscopes that were produced in that particular article, we went through all these articles, and we found that invariably in all those horoscopes, these two conditions were satisfied in terms of the transit of Jupiter and Saturn. Now, let me give you a different, you know, scenario where you are trying to analyze this particular theory using a critical approach. When I say a critical approach, it doesn't tend to undermine anybody's effort. It is just, you know, you're trying to see that if theory actually works the way, you know, it is propounded. So let's look at this particular example. The same chart of that female, she got married in year 1984. Now let me remove, you know, this particular year from your view. Now you are not aware that this female got married in 84. And let's look at a scenario where you are approached by the parents of this particular girl to find out when this girl is going to get married. Now in India, the usually when the girls, you know, they reach a marriageable age, that becomes a time of great concern for the parents. And this is a very unfortunate and sad state of affairs in India, that they want to get the daughters married as soon as possible. So now there is a pressure on you from the parent. And let's assume that you met the parent in year 1980. And the great concern on the parent's mind is that when this particular female, their daughter, is going to get married. Now let's apply this theory, particular theory. Year 1980, Jupiter was in Leo, and then it got into Virgo sometime, I guess, in October, November, something. Saturn was in Virgo, it got retrograde, went into Leo, and then became direct and went into Virgo. Now, let's look at Jupiter. Is Jupiter fulfilling these conditions? Jupiter has to aspect the Lagna Lord, 7th or 7th house. Jupiter is in Leo. So from here, from Leo, it's aspecting the Lagna Lord. And when Jupiter goes to Virgo, which is here, then it is conjoined with Mars, which is the Lord of the 7th house. Let's look at Saturn. Saturn in Virgo means Saturn is with the Lagna Lord. Saturn in Leo means Saturn is, from here it is aspecting the 7th house. And then again in Virgo. So if you stick to this particular rule that was propounded, then you would say, okay, your daughter, this is how you are going to predict that your daughter is going to get married in 1980. Now she doesn't get married in 1980. So then you move on to 1981. Jupiter is in Virgo. Virgo we have already seen. If Jupiter is in Virgo, Jupiter is already fulfilling this condition, being with Mars, who is the Lagna Lord. And then Jupiter in 81 also, you know, moved on to Libra. So Libra is anyway the 7th house. And Saturn is in Virgo. So Virgo we know that in Virgo, Jupiter and Saturn is going to fulfill this condition. So then you predict, okay, she is not going to get married in 81. Same is going to happen in 82. If you look at these transit position, only in 83 this will not happen because Jupiter is in Scorpio. And from Scorpio, it will not be able to fulfill this condition. But in 84, again, Jupiter and Saturn will fulfill the condition. In 85, 86, 87. So pretty much all the years, marriageable years, you know, you will find that this particular condition is fulfilled. So like I mentioned, when you have a horoscope where you really don't know and you want to make a prediction, and if you rely on these kind of a theory with these kind of very tall claims that this will work in 90% and all that, then you have to take it with a pinch of salt, where your critical approach and analytical approach, without disrespect for the person who has propounded this theory, and they, you have to run, you know, some tests like we did, and then we realized that this theory was just too broad, and that whole double transit theory was true in all the horoscope for almost all the time. So you can't possibly fall back or depend on this theory, like this Nadi astrologer, when he was saying that he still uses. I was very surprised at how he is not able to eliminate all these years. Or does he know anything that how to eliminate all these years? Otherwise, year after year after year, any astrologer or that astrologer is going to predict, okay, this year she is going to get married, this year she is going to get married. So what do we do with the analytical and critical approach? When a theory is propounded and it gains some tempo or some limelight, in the astrological world, then we don't have to accept it prima facie. We don't have to accept it on the face value. You have to run your own test. And I'm not saying this about Mr. K.N. Rao or any other person. Even if I propound anything, you know, then as a good astrologer, you should have that kind of a critical and analytical facility. So when we started running some tests and we found that this theory was too broad and we couldn't depend on this theory, so what we did, these are the stuff that we did personally. You might have a different approach, but I just want to share that when I say a critical and analytical approach, what I mean by that. What we did was that we brought the, we thought that the whole Rashi chart, just relying on the Rashi chart was not sufficient. So we have to bring some other factor. So we brought the Navansh chart into the picture. Sorry about that. We brought the Navansh chart into the picture. We wanted to put some more conditions on this theory so that we can eliminate all the tempting years and arrive at something which was, you know, valuable and that could be predicted with some degree of confidence. Now, if you look at this Navansh chart, I have, let me remove this also. I have kept only, you know, the Venus in this Navansh chart because that is all we are concerned with. Venus is the seventh lord and I have removed even the Mars, which is the Lagna lord. And if you look at the original Navansh chart, the ascendant is Cancer and Venus is in Aries. But if you look at this particular chart, here I have not used Cancer as the Navansh ascendant, I have used the Aries. And I'll explain you in a while that why, you know, I have used Aries for this particular, you know, analysis. And so what we did was that we said, okay, let's put, you know, another condition to this double transit theory. Now, the first hypothesis was that should we use the double transit? That is the very first critical and analytical approach, that why we should use the double transit. Why not about other transit like Mercury and Venus and Sun and all that? So we discussed and we said, okay, Jupiter and Saturn are slow moving and these are very fast moving planets. So it's very difficult and very cumbersome and very tedious, a very long winding process to follow the faster moving planets like Sun and Venus and Mercury. So we said that we will stick to the Jupiter and Saturn transit position. And apart from that, in a lot of Nadi books, especially by C.S. Patel, time and again, he has mentioned about the Jupiter and Saturn transit. So we said, okay, Jupiter and Saturn seems to have a very special significance in the Indian astrology. So let's stick with Jupiter and Saturn, not only for the practical reason, but there are other, you know, significance attached to the Jupiter and the Saturn transit. So that was the first condition. And why Navansh? Well, that was just our choice. And a lot of, we had a small study circle and we all were very fascinated with Navansh and we thought there are a lot of secrets, you know, hidden in Navansh. So let's take Navansh. You could as well use, you know, the D7 or the Saptamansh chart. But our preference was that let's use, you know, the Navansh chart. And now to put a more strict condition, what we did was that we said that, okay, these conditions might be applicable in the Rashi chart. So these conditions might be applicable in the Rashi chart. But in the Navansh chart, we are going to remove this condition. We are going to remove this condition, especially, you know, if you look at the Navansh chart, the ascendant is same, like in the Rashi chart. This chart has been rotated. The actual Navansh ascendant is Cancer. But the Rashi ascendant has been taken. So this is, I think it's called a Karakansh Navansh, where the Rashi ascendant is taken, but the planets are placed according to the Navansh position. So for the Navansh reckoning, we said, okay, we are going to remove all these conditions and only rely on the seventh lord. So for the Navansh chart, Rashi chart, we don't have to look. We already know that year after year, the Saturn and Jupiter transit in one or the other way is going to agree with all these conditions. But in the Navan chart, we said that Saturn and Jupiter must have something to do only with the seventh lord. Now, if you apply the second set of condition, where you say that Saturn and Jupiter must have something to do with the seventh lord, and if you look at the year 80, now Jupiter is in Leo. So Jupiter goes here. From here, it is aspecting the seventh lord. But if you look at Saturn, Saturn from Virgo has nothing to do with Venus. Okay, and when Saturn became retrograde, by that time Jupiter got into Virgo. So Jupiter got here in Virgo, and it had nothing to do with the seventh lord. So then you say, okay, this condition is not fulfilled for this year. Similarly, if you look for 81, 82, all these transits have been given. So you will find that only the year 84 is the year when these conditions are fulfilled, where Saturn and Jupiter must aspect these conditions, which we know that they are. In 84, the Jupiter was in Sagittarius. So from Sagittarius, it was aspecting the not only the seventh lord, but also the Lagna in the Rashi. And Saturn was in Libra, so Saturn was already here. But if you look at the Navansh, you will find that out of all these years, 84 is the only year when this particular transit will agree. Now, if you focus your attention on the Navansh chart, you find that the Jupiter is in Sagittarius. And for the Navansh chart, the condition is that it has to do something with the seventh lord. We are not concerned with all these conditions in the Navansh chart. So Jupiter from here is aspecting Venus, which is the seventh lord. And Saturn was in Libra. So Saturn from here is aspecting Venus, which is the seventh lord. So by adding another condition, you were able to eliminate all these, you know, years. And you said, okay, now 84 looks as one of the good year in terms of marriage. But you shouldn't stop here. You should actually go further, because here what we are doing is we are only using two charts, the Rashi and Navansh. Ideally, I would recommend that you should go for something called rule of three, where you make use of at least three different conditions. So what is the third condition that you can bring in? You have to think about it. And at our case, when we thought that what is the third condition, so we said, okay, let's bring in the Mahadashanath into the picture. And I think this female, she was going through Saturn period or Mercury period at that time. And if you look at the transit of Saturn, then you find that, the Jupiter, then you find that Jupiter from Sagittarius is aspecting the Mahadasha Lord, the Mercury, and Saturn was in Libra, so Saturn from Libra was also aspecting the Mahadasha Lord. So this is how you bring in the third condition. So then what happens is you get four, five or six, you know, different kind of conditions, and then you say, okay, out of these four or five or six, whatever, you know, more it is better, out of these, you know, maximum conditions are fulfilled in this condition, in this particular transit. So then you can be sure that, okay, you know, this particular transit is going to work. And when I mentioned the rule of three, is just like, you know, in the medicine field, you know, a medical practitioner, what a medical practitioner does, if you have some ailment and then he says, okay, let me do a blood test, and then that particular doctor, the medical practitioner, is not sure that the blood test alone is able to identify what kind of problem you have. So then he or she says, okay, let me do a X-ray. And even then, if it's not sure, then he says, okay, let me run some more, you know, pathological test. And then that particular doctor or the medical practitioner combines all these results. And then they find a common thread across all these things. And this is how they derive that, okay, this is the problem that you have. Same kind of approach. This is a very proven scientific approach that happens in science, and this is what we have to take in astrology also. You have to be critical, you have to analytical, and you have to run not only one just one set of theory. That is not sufficient. You have to run several different set of theories and see that if how many conditions are being fulfilled from various angles. It takes effort, no doubt. It takes efforts. It also takes time. You can make use of computer these days, and most importantly, if you have a team, which I asserted in one of my videos, that if you have a team, that teamwork alone can do wonders. And this is how slowly then you can evolve that, okay, this particular, theory seems more plausible, and this is the approach we should take. Now, one of the questions that recently I got from one of my friend in the email, he said that, okay, if we propound this theory, will it work 100%? I said, no, this is not going to work 100%. Even in medical side, despite running all these tests, sometimes, the analysis or the conclusion is not 100%. And astrology is not a science. A lot of people call it a science, but I just call it an art. It's not a science, it's an art. More you put your effort into it, more you delve into it, more refined you become in the astrology of art. So 70% or more than 70% result if you get by following a critical, analytical, and statistical approach, that alone is sufficient. 25-30% of predictions will go incorrect. So that's not a big deal. If you think that all K.N. Rao's 100% predictions are true, that's incorrect. Or B.V. Raman's predictions are true, that is also incorrect. Even Krishnamurti, he also made, a lot of incorrect predictions. You cannot be God. No astrologer can be a God. But you can be as accurate as possible by using a critical and analytical approach. And this is what I follow. So I thought this is what I should be sharing, with some of you. Now, before I conclude this video, one of the things that I mentioned about, that why this particular Navansh was taken, where the Rashi chart was rotated on the same angle, but the planets were populated according to their placement in the Navansh. Though the original Navansh horoscope of this female is with the Cancer, ascendant. Now, what happened is recently I was watching one video where some of the participants were discussing about the Shodashvark, and they were discussing about what happens when the ascendant in the D12 or D30 is this or that, and they were just quoting, some of the text from Parashar and all that. These kind of videos are very misleading. Don't rely on that. When a person says, okay, in D30, which is the 30th division of ascendant, this is what Rishi Parashar says, that if Jupiter is here, this will happen. So you have to say, oh, okay, that's true. But if you divide ascendant into 30th part, how do you know that this particular ascendant is correct or not? We even don't know what is the true time of birth. Even the time of birth, right from the appearance of the head of the child, and until that child takes his first breath, it takes 2-3 minutes. And if you run a calculation in any horoscope with 2-3 minutes of difference, you will find that all these Shodashvarga chart, they show different, ascendant. So as a critical and analytical approach, then you have to sit up and think that, you know what, this ascendant might change. So what do I do? So in this case, what we did was, and we ran into this kind of a issue, where when we were taking the original ascendant, sorry, the Navansh, then we said that there's a lot of deviation, and we had a doubt in our mind that whether this ascendant is correct or not, this ascendant could be something else in the Navansh chart. So we said, okay, let's do a little safe play over here, and let's go for the Karakansha Navansh, where the Rashi ascendant is taken, only the planets are populated according to the Navansh value. Now, some of these discussions that you hear, these people, they don't care about it. They even don't think about it. And they seem to be so sure about talking about D60 and D thing, all these, various divisional charts, that, okay, it's good to watch this video and learn something. But all these questions, when you are taking a critical and analytical approach, should come to your mind that the ascendant might change, and we don't have any method about, fixing the accurate, ascendant. So at that time, what are the other things that are given, you know, in our the Jyotish text. And one of the Karakas Navamsh is a very good hint that you can use the original ascendant and then populate the planet according to the other, you know, division. So these are some of the things, you know, that came to my mind, and I thought that I will be sharing with you. And if you take this kind of a critical and analytical approach, a lot of people, they have a good a theory to discuss, but don't accept it on the face value. Do your effort. Sometime it will be frustrating. Sometime it will take some time. But out of this alone, something will emerge that will become valuable for you. So that's all in this presentation. I hope you enjoyed watching it. Thank you.